بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We are on the Bab al-Dhabaih, and in the previous track we mentioned some preliminary words and rulings. Let us now move on to the ahadith of the chapter. Number 1175. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن قوما قالوا للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن قوما يأتوننا باللحم لا ندري أذكر اسم الله عليه أم لا فقال سموا الله عليه أنتم وَكُلُوا رواه البخاري. From Aisha, she says that some people came to the Prophet and they said that there are some people who bring us meat, but we don't know if they have mentioned the name of Allah over this meat or not. And the Prophet replied, you people mention the name of Allah and then eat it. Al-Bukhari reported it. Some scholars have used this narration to prove that the Bismillah before you sacrifice is not obligatory and it is not a condition, because these people who came to the Prophet, they were in doubt as to whether this Bismillah has been mentioned or not. But yet despite this, the Prophet told them to eat the meat. Had saying the Bismillah been a condition, then we would have to ascertain whether the condition has been met or not. Because if the condition has not been met, then clearly you would not be allowed to eat this meat. So because the Prophet did not tell them to make sure, they say that at best saying the Bismillah would be mustahab and not wajib, and certainly not a condition. However, this is not the correct opinion. We say that at best this hadith is mutashabih. It is unclear and it could be interpreted one way or the other. But the better interpretation of this hadith would be this following interpretation. We say that if the correct people sacrifice the meat, then the asl on that is that the meat is halal to be eaten. And we don't inquire and go deeper into the issue. We simply go by the asl that it is halal and that's it. And the reason why we opt for this interpretation is because we have other clear-cut evidence which tells us that if the meat comes from the Jews, Christians or Muslim, meaning if they have sacrificed the meat, then the asl is that it is halal. We can also take from the hadith that saying the Bismillah when you sacrifice the animal, this was a practice well known amongst the Prophet and the companions, because if it was not well known, then the people would not have asked the Prophet about this. It would have simply been a non-issue. But the fact that they're asking means that they're hesitant. And this would show us that this was a practice well known amongst the Prophet and the companions. We also take from the hadith the wara' of the Sahaba, in that they are asking the Prophet just to make sure. Al-wara' is when you leave off something you fear will harm you in the Akhirah. So clearly the Sahaba are fearing that eating this meat will harm them in the Akhirah, because the meat may not be halal. And we also take that you are not responsible for what other people do. So other people sacrifice the meat, as long as they are Muslim, then the asl is that it is halal to be eaten and you don't need to question any further and you are not held responsible. The Prophet told them that you say Bismillah and eat it. This is nothing to do with the actual sacrifice, this is only to do with the eating. Remember, when you eat, you must say Bismillah first, and this is wajib, not mustahab, because otherwise the shaytan is going to share in this food. When a man eats food and he does not say Bismillah, then the shaytan says to his fellow shayateen, وَجَدْتُمُ الْعَشَىٰ, you have found your evening meal. Likewise, when a man enters his home and he does not say Bismillah, then the shaytan says to his fellow shayateen, وَجَدْتُمُ الْمَبِيتِ, you have found a place to stay the night. And this narration is in Sahih Muslim. If you forget to say the Bismillah before you eat and you remember it during your meal, then you say, as is reported, Bismillahi أَوَّلَهُ وَآخِرَةً, with the name of Allah from the beginning and the end. If you forget to say the Bismillah until you finish eating the meal, then you don't have to say Bismillah because the time of saying it has passed, but rather you simply praise Allah جَلَّ وَعَلَى by saying Alhamdulillah, or any other dua that has been reported for when you finish eating. Also, we take from the narration that don't make life difficult for yourself by asking too many questions. Keep it simple. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ أَعْظَمَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ ظُلْمًا مَنْ سَأَلَ عَنْ شَيْءٍ لَمْ يُحَرَّمْ فَحُرِّمَ مِنْ أَجْلِ مَسْأَلَتِهِ. The greatest oppressor from the Muslims is the one who asks about something which is not haram, but then it becomes haram because of his question. So if something is plain and simple, keep it plain and simple. Don't go too deep into asking about these affairs. And with this particular incident, What makes the suspicion of these Muslims even more justified is that the people who slaughtered this meat were newly converted to Islam. So there is every possibility that they did not mention the name of Allah, because this is not something which they would be used to doing. But despite this, the Prophet ﷺ said, no, don't go into too much detail. Just take it on the face value, or that which is apparent, and go by the asl, that it is halal. However, with this hadith, we come on to an important issue. What about the meat in these Christian countries? We know the sacrificed meat of the Christians is halal to be eaten by the text of the Quran. So we go along with this asl that yes, their meat is halal to be eaten. But we say this, this is the asl. However, if we have some other evidence which takes the ruling away from the asl, then we go along with that ruling. In our current day and age, we do have such evidence. We know for sure that these animals which they slaughter are subject to electric stuns. And so if an animal dies in this way, then it becomes like the animal which has died through taking a blow or a butted animal, which is mentioned in the Quran, of course. And that sort of animal is haram to be eaten. Thus, the animal which has been stunned with electricity and dies like this is haram to be eaten, even if it comes from the Christians or the Jews. Because the asl is that the slaughtered meat of the Christians and the Jews is halal to be eaten as long as we don't have any other evidence to take it away from this ruling. But in this day and age, we do have evidence. We know for sure that the animals are killed through stunning, hence this meat is not halal to be eaten. Except the Jews, however, it appears still practice their original teachings, and they sacrifice the animal much in the same way that the Muslims would sacrifice the animal, by making the blood flow. So if that's the case, then the meat from the Jews would be halal. But what about electric stuns anyway? Is a Muslim allowed to do this? Well, we say if the electricity is such that it will cause pain to the animal, then this is haram, and a Muslim must therefore avoid doing this. If the electric stun is of a light load, such that it would not cause pain to the animal, but it would simply knock it out unconscious, such that it's unconscious but still alive, in that the heart is still beating, and then the Muslim sacrifices the animal, meaning cuts off the veins in the neck area, and he sacrifices it in this way, then this is halal, because you have not sacrificed a dead animal, rather you have sacrificed a living animal. If it be the case that you know that somebody has stunned the animal, but you're not sure whether the animal survived the stun or not, then in this case you are on the safe side and you leave off this type of meat due to the hadith, دَعْ مَا يَرِيبُكْ إِلَى مَا لَا يَرِيبُكْ. Leave that which makes you doubt to that which does not make you doubt. So if the haram and the halal are in equal portions, let's say 50-50, then you err on the side of caution and you give precedence to the haram. Hadith 1166, وعن عبد الله بن مغفل رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نهى عن الخذف وقال إنها لا تصيد صيدا ولا تنكأ عدوا ولكنها تكسر السن وتفقع العين. متفق عليه واللفظ لمسلم. From Abdullah ibn Mughaffal, he says that the Prophet forbade hurling stones. And the Prophet said that this does not hunt any animal and it does not injure any enemy, but rather the only thing it does is that it will break a tooth or pop an eye. This prohibition of throwing stones is that it is makruh as long as it does not break anyone's tooth or pops anyone's eye out, in which case it would be haram for you to do so. And also, if you were to hunt an animal by throwing stones, then this would not be a proper hunting, so the meat would not be halal unless you manage to sacrifice it before it dies. Also, we take from this hadith the good teaching technique. The Prophet gives a ruling and the reason afterwards. Also, we take you don't fight the enemies by throwing stones. Rather, if you want to fight them, then you fight them with weapons similar or superior to theirs. And naturally, this would be the sensible thing to do. So many people might just fight the ruler, let's say, with whatever meager weapons that they have. And this is wrong. If you're going to fight someone, then it has to be with weapons that can counteract theirs. So if, let's say, in a Muslim country, the ruler turns into a kafir, and it is clear-cut that he is a kafir, and the Muslims want to oust him from power, then this would be permissible as long as they have the ability to do so. So we're talking about the military ability. As for if they do not have the military ability to do so, then it is better for them at this point to keep patient. Because one of the conditions for rebelling against the kafir ruler is that you have the ability to rebel against him. And oftentimes what we see happening is that when a people would rebel against a ruler simply based on their desires or they hate the ruler, then the new ruler who comes in turns out to be worse than the previous one. So generally speaking, these uprisings against rulers do not produce the fruits which people want. Rather, it would be better for them to keep patient, and Allah Jalla wa Ala will find a way out for them. And similar to this would be putting a stone in a catapult and then stretching out the catapult and hurling the stone at a bird, let's say, which many people do. Then this type of thing should not be done. It is simply giving pain to the animal. And in a hadith, which some scholars have graded authentic, the Prophet ﷺ said in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad and others, whoever kills a sparrow without due right, then Allah will ask him about it on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the people said, what is the due right of the sparrow? And the Prophet said that you should give it a proper dhabh, proper sacrifice, and do not take it and just rip its neck off. So hurling stones at animals then is impermissible. Likewise, hurling stones at enemies is useless, as the Prophet says, it does not injure the enemy. Rather, if you want to fight the enemy, use weapons which are similar to their weapons or superior. Hadith 1167, وَعَنِ ابْنِ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمَا أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ لَا تَتَّخِذُوا شَيْئًا فِيهِ الرُّوحُ غَرَضًا رواه مسلم. From Ibn Abbas, the Prophet said, do not take as target practice anything which has a soul. Muslim reported it. So this hadith is somewhat linked to the previous hadith. The prohibition here is that it is haram because you're causing harm. And we know generally you're not allowed to cause harm to anyone. And so we find from this hadith the rahmah which the Sharia inculcates in its followers. And if you take an animal for target practice and just kill it in this way, then this also counts as destroying wealth because this animal could be slaughtered properly and made use of. However, what about an animal which is already dead? It does not have a soul now. Can it then be taken as target practice? The answer is yes, as long as you are not destroying any wealth. Because even a dead animal could be made use of. But if we have, let's say, a dead animal and you have a bird of prey which hunts for you, then you can use this dead animal to train this bird of prey. So yes, here you are using this animal as target practice to train your bird. So this would be permissible. Likewise, in the Sahihain, the Prophet ﷺ forbade killing an animal by way of sabr. And this is when you would just hold an animal back and it dies out of hunger. So the Sharia forbids any practice of causing pain and injury to the animal. Sure, when you sacrifice it, it may suffer some pain. However, the benefits outweigh the harm. So that's why the dhabh is permissible. Also, it is worth adding that having fights between animals, such as dog fights and cock fights, are also impermissible because it unnecessarily produces harm on animals.
Hadith 1168, وعن كعب بن مالك رضي الله عنه أن امرأة ذبحت شاة بحجر فسئل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك فأمر بأكلها رواه البخاري. From كعب بن مالك, that a woman sacrificed a sheep using a stone, and the Prophet was asked about this and he ordered the meat to be eaten. Al-Bukhari reported it. We can take a simple lesson from this hadith that it is permissible to sacrifice an animal using a stone as long as the stone is sharp and will make the blood flow. We also take a simple lesson that the sacrificed meat of a woman is permissible to be eaten. Does this include a woman in menstruation? The answer is yes, it does, because the hadith is general. And likewise, a person in state of janaba also can sacrifice an animal and the meat is halal to be eaten. There's no problem there. The full narration in Al-Bukhari says that there used to be some sheep and a servant girl saw one sheep about to die. So instead of allowing it to die a natural death, she cut off a stone so that the stone was sharp and she sacrificed the sheep. The sheep did not belong to her, but because it was going to die anyway, she sacrificed it, thus making it halal. So we can also take from the fuller version that if you are an amin or entrusted with something, then you can do with it as you see most fitting, even if the owner has not permitted it. So here the woman has sacrificed the sheep, yet the sheep did not belong to her. And this is because this would be the most sensible thing to do, because the sheep is going to die anyway, and if it dies a natural death, it would be haram to eat. Remember what we said about the animal who is about to die. As long as he has full life in him, then you can sacrifice it. And the way you know is that if you were to sacrifice this animal and the blood which comes out is warm and ready color, then this is an animal which had full life and the sacrifice is correct. If the animal's blood is of a darker color, so there's less oxygen and it is also colder, then this dhabh would not be correct because the animal did not have full life when you sacrificed it. So this is the way to tell. Hadith 1169 وعن رافع بن خديج رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما أنهر الدم وذكر اسم الله عليه فكلوا ليس السن والظفر أما السن فعظم وأما الظفر فمدى الحبشة متفق عليه. From رافع بن خديج, the Prophet says, whatever makes the blood flow copiously and the name of Allah has been mentioned over it, then eat it, apart from sacrificing using tooth and nail. As for the tooth, then this is a type of bone, and as for the nail, then this is what the Habasha or the Abyssinians use to sacrifice their animal. Muttafaqun alayh. So we find from this hadith then that from the conditions of the dhabiha to be halal is that the blood must flow copiously and that the name of Allah should be mentioned. As for the tasmiyah, we spoke about this, but we haven't yet spoken about this idea of the blood flowing. So we find here you can use any instrument to make the blood flow, except for the ones mentioned in the hadith. And remember, we also said that the instrument must be sharp. This is an obligation. What about if the instrument you're using is made of, let's say, silver? Are you allowed to use that to cut the animal's neck? The answer is yes. It is only prohibited to eat and drink from the silver vessel. You can also argue the same thing with gold, except the gold for males, some may argue that the prohibition is general, so it includes wearing gold, but also using gold in general. So for the male, it is better to avoid this gold. In the neck region, you have the two jugular veins, then you have the windpipe, and also the food pipe. So we have four channels which can be cut. Now, if all four of them are cut, then that's fair enough. But there's a difference of opinion as to when less than four are cut. Some scholars said that if the windpipe and the food pipe are only cut, then this would suffice, even if the jugular vein is not cut. There is a narration, albeit slightly weak, in the Sunan, in which the Prophet forbade the cutting of the shaitan, and this is where you would cut off the windpipe and the food pipe without any of the jugular veins. As for if you only cut the windpipe or you only cut the food pipe and nothing else, then there is no difference of opinion that this meat is not halal. If you were to cut the two jugular veins only, then certainly this would make the blood flow and hence you would be obeying the hadith, so we would say that it would be permissible if you only cut the two jugular veins. Even though the hadith does not specifically say that the cutting needs to be on the neck area, but we say that if you want to make the blood flow copiously, then it would have to be on the neck area. So we would obligate the slaughterer to focus on the neck area and not any other part of the body. Of course, when you're hunting, it's different, like we said before. It is impractical to focus on the neck area. You simply cannot do it. And so any part of the body would suffice as long as the blood flows. The hadith tells us you're not allowed to use a tooth to offer the sacrifice. And the reason for this is because the tooth is classified as a type of bone. Now, what do we know about bones? They are the food for the jinn. If this bone from the animal which was sacrificed had the name of Allah mentioned over it, then this bone would be halal for the jinn to eat. In fact, the Prophet says that they would find it as meat. Of course, we don't find it as meat, but in the world of jinn, they will find it as meat. On the other hand, if this bone did not have the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala mentioned over it, then this means that this bone is najis, according to most of the scholars, and you cannot use something najis to purify an animal. Remember, the dhabh is there to purify this dead animal, because the dead meat is impure. So how can you use something which is najis to purify something? It does not make sense. With regards to mentioning the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala, then it must be a dhikr, it must not be you calling out to Allah. So if you say Ya Allah or Allahumma, then this is a calling out to Allah Jalla wa Ala, and this does not suffice. Rather, the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala must be mentioned in a dhikr format, not in a dua format. What about if somebody uses a knife to sacrifice the animal, but this knife has been stolen or usurped from someone else? Well, we say it is haram for him to use this knife. Rather, what is obligatory is to return it. But if he was to sacrifice the animal, then the sacrifice would be correct as long as all the other conditions have been met, though he would still be sinful in using this knife. In fact, he would be sinful for as long as this knife is in his possession. As for the nail which the Prophet mentions here, what is apparent is that this is the nail of a human. The Habasha would grow their nails long, and they'll be able to sacrifice the animal using their nails. And clearly this is an imitation of the beast of prey, who would use their claws to catch their prey. Likewise with the birds of prey, who use their talons to catch their prey. So you'd be imitating these wild beasts, and this is not fitting. And you would also be imitating the misguided Habasha, which is again not fitting. If a dhabh is carried out using the tooth or the human nail, then this dhabiha is not permitted to eat. And the reason is because this matter goes against what the Sharia has ordered, so any action which is not in accordance with this matter of ours is rejected. So not only is it haram for you to use these items, but also the dhabh is not permitted. So contrast this with a knife which you have stolen. That dhabh is permitted, meaning the meat is not haram, it is halal to eat, despite you doing haram in using this knife. Whereas when it comes to the tooth and the nail, then not only is this haram to be done, but also the meat would not be halal to be eaten. Because here you have directly opposed a prohibition. Whereas the prohibition on the usurped item applies to whether you use it to sacrifice or not. That prohibition is not specific to the dhabh. Whereas this prohibition is specific to the dhabh. Also, it is worth knowing that when you are about to sacrifice an animal, do not sharpen the blade in front of the animal, because this animal will understand that you are trying to slaughter it, and so you will cause unnecessary fear. Hadith 1170. وعن جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما قال نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يقتل شيء من الدواب صبرا رواه مسلم. From Jabir ibn Abdullah, he says, the Prophet forbade any animal to be killed as sabr, which is when you hold it back and you throw something on it until it dies. So you use it as target practice. You'll remember a few ahadith back, the Prophet forbade anything with a soul to be taken as target practice, which is when you would throw things at it and simply take it as target practice. Well, this hadith has the same meaning. When you kill something out of sabr is when you hold it back and use it as target practice. And this is because there is unnecessary suffering for the animal with this, and the Sharia is a deen of rahmah to even the animals. This is why it is wajib to sharpen the blade when you kill the animal in the sacrifice, so as to spare the suffering, because with a blunt blade is going to prolong the suffering. And killing the animal in this way, out of sabr, is wasting wealth. And this animal could have been killed through a proper zakah, but now you've deprived everyone else of this opportunity. So we find that with this type of killing, there is mafasid, which means there is much corruption with this, and there is no good which comes out of it. Also, let it be noted that killing an animal sabran may also mean just holding it back until it starves to death. Just like the hadith we mentioned about the woman who held the cat back until it starved to death. That was also sabran.
Hadith 1171. وعن شداد بن عوس رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله كتب الإحسان على كل شيء فإذا قتلتم فأحسنوا القتلة وإذا ذبحتم فأحسنوا الذبحة وليحد أحدكم شفرته وليرح ذبيحته رواه مسلم. From Shaddad ibn Aws, the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah has ordained ihsan, or doing things well, in all things. So when you kill, kill well. When you perform the zakah, then do it well. And let one of you sharpen his blade and spare the animal suffering. Muslim reported it. In this hadith, the word kataba is used, which means ordained. And this ordainment can be of two types, kitab kawni and kitab shara'i. We spoke about the difference earlier on. And we said that this kitab here is the kitab shara'i, the ordainment from the sharia
point of view. So this means that Allah Jalla wa'ala loves that this should happen, but it may or may not happen, because it could be that somebody completely disobeys this hadith. We know Allah Jalla wa'ala loves Ihsan and the people of Ihsan, who are the Muhsinun. As Allah says, وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And do good, Allah loves those who do good. But when it comes to Ihsan, then the Sharia itself defines what Ihsan is. So for example, when it comes to the adulterer and stoning him to death, on the face of it, this looks like a horrid punishment. And one might ask, how is this Ihsan? This is clearly a horrid punishment. We say no, this is Ihsan, because the Sharia defines what Ihsan is. So if you were to give him any other punishment, then this would not be Ihsan. Or for example, many people would complain about cutting off the thief's hand. How is this Ihsan? We say no, this is exactly what Ihsan is. In fact, not cutting off his hand, if proven guilty and if the conditions are met, so not cutting his hand off under these circumstances, that would not be Ihsan. Why? Because you have opposed the Sharia. So with this hadith then, we find that the Sharia is merciful to the animals even when sacrificing them. The Ihsan could be divided into two categories, the type of Ihsan which is wajib, and this would be giving Allah Jalla wa'ala his due rights with regards to worship, giving other people their due rights with regards to the way you treat them, being honest with them, dealing with them with justice, and all these other obligatory traits that a Muslim must have. But then an Ihsan could also be mustahab, for example, giving somebody a gift. It is not wajib, but it is recommended, and it would be Ihsan. One of the most difficult forms of Ihsan is to treat well somebody who mistreats you, because the natural reaction would be to treat him badly, just like he's treated you badly. It takes a strong man to treat the other person well who has treated you badly. And so Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ. The good deed and the evil deed are not equal. ادفع بالتي هي أحسن فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. Repel the evil treatment with good treatment. So if you're treated badly by someone, treat him well. But what will be the result of this? Allah says, then the one between you and him, there was enmity, would become as if he was a close bosom buddy. وَمَا يُلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا وَمَا يُلَقَّاهَا إِلَّا ذُو حَظٍ عَظِيمٍ. None can reach this status, or none will be able to do this except those who are patient, and none will be able to achieve this except those who have a large share of reward in the hereafter, and also a large portion of good character. So Ihsan is in all things, but the hadith just gives two examples, one in killing and one in slaughter. Because if there were two actions only in which a person would not deem Ihsan to be important, it would be these two actions. So when it comes to killing, then we are talking about the had punishments if you have to kill somebody. Somebody might say, well, you're killing him anyway as a had punishment, so let's just have a little bit of fun and chop him up into pieces because he's going to die anyway. We may as well make it fun. No, the Sharia prohibits this. It is obligatory to do things with Ihsan. So when it comes to the had punishments and when you're killing somebody, then it needs to be a swift killing, unless otherwise stated. And you do not take advantage of the person who is about to be killed from the had punishment, because this is not Ihsan. So for example, with the stoning to death, the ulama say, it is not a swift death, obviously, but the point about that is the adulterer enjoyed the pleasure on the whole of his body. So as a fitting punishment, he must experience pain on the whole of his body before dying. This is at least one of the reasons why that particular punishment is not a swift death. Otherwise, it should be a swift death. And the second issue somebody may take liberties with is sacrificing the animal. Hey, the animal is going to die anyway, so we can just do it however we want to. No, there are guidelines. So you must, by way of obligation, sharpen the blade, because a blunt blade will cause unnecessary pain. Also, when you're sharpening the blade, don't do it in front of the animal, because the animal will realize that you're trying to kill it. Also, don't do it in front of the animal's fellow animals, because you will frighten them unnecessarily. And when it comes to sacrificing the animals, then the camel, and also possibly the horse, are to be given the nahar, which is when you stab the base of the neck.
The ulama say that this is easier to do with these types of animals. As with the other types of animals, you give them the dhabh, which is the horizontal cutting across the neck. They say it's a flexible issue, but this is the better way. And also, like we said before, the neck should not be broken off until the animal is fully dead. And when you are sacrificing the sheep, do not tie its legs. Rather, let it move its legs around as it is dying, because this would be easier for the animal. It would reduce the pain. What about facing the animal towards the Qibla? Well, when it comes to sacrificing the Udhiyah, which is done during the days of the Hajj, 10th, 11th, 12th and 13th, then we could argue because this is a particular act of worship, then you can face the Qibla, but it is far less emphasized when you are sacrificing the animal just for food, because that in and of itself is not an act of worship. So to sum up then, Ihsan is obligatory in all things you do in life. But the hadith mentions these two particular examples because these two scenarios are most likely where people would not observe Ihsan. Hadith 1172. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم زكاة الجنين زكاة أمه رواه أحمد وصححه ابن حبان. From Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the Prophet said that the zakah, or the sacrifice of the baby in the belly, is the sacrifice of its mother. The hadith is sahih. This hadith, the scholars have interpreted it in two different ways. One opinion is that the zakah of the janin is like the zakah of the mother. So the mother you would sacrifice by cutting the throat. So likewise with the janin, the baby inside the belly, you would also have to cut its throat and sacrifice it likewise. So if the child, for example, is born dead because the mother died, then this is dead meat and you're not allowed to eat it because it was not sacrificed just as the mother was sacrificed. The second opinion on this issue is that by the mere fact that the mother has been given the zakah, and if the baby is born dead, then it is also halal, because it is in following with the mother. So if the baby is born dead, then it is just as if it was given the normal zakah of the mother. So based upon this opinion, if the baby is born dead or comes out dead, it is halal to eat because it has been sacrificed properly by virtue of the fact that its mother was sacrificed properly. So you can see that these opinions are diametrically opposed to when it comes to the child being born dead. One opinion says haram, the other one says halal. The correct opinion is the second one. If the child is born dead, as long as the mother was given the proper zakah, then the meat of the child is halal to eat. Because if we understand it in the first opinion, that the child needs to be given the same kind of zakah as the mother, then there would be no difference between the janin, the baby in the belly, and any other animal. Because we already know that all types of animals which are halal to eat must be given the proper type of zakah. So, based upon that opinion, this hadith would not be telling us anything particularly new. And then secondly, we can say that as soon as the child comes out of the belly, he's no longer a janin, because a janin is, by definition, inside the belly. This could be argued back, however, they could say that the Sharia is speaking with a view to what was, not with a view to what is now, as in the statement of Allah, وَآتُ الْيَتَامَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ, and give the orphans their wealth. Well, as soon as they're old enough to receive their wealth, they by definition are no longer orphans, but the Sharia calls them orphans. Why is this? It is because it is speaking with a view to what was previously, not what is now currently. Whereas this is certainly true, however, we say that we only interpret it like this, meaning interpreting a word with a view to what was, if we have a particular indication. Otherwise, the asl is we interpret the word with respect to what it is now currently. And the second opinion further makes sense because it grants us great ease, and it is from the lightening of the load and makes life easier. And it also prevents this meat of the janin from going to waste. And also, if we wanted to sacrifice the janin, then what are we supposed to do? Split open the mother's belly, take the janin out and give it the sacrifice? Clearly, this will be torture to the mother. If you have sacrificed the mother and the janin comes out alive, then there is no question about it, you must sacrifice it as normal. Hadith 1173. وعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال المسلم يكفيه اسمه فإن نسي أن يسمي حين يذبح فليسمي ثم ليأكل. أخرجه الدارقطني وفي إسناده محمد ابن يزيد ابن سنان وهو صدوق ضعيف الحفظ، وأخرجه عبد الرزاق بإسناد صحيح إلى ابن عباس موقوفا عليه، وله شاهد عند أبي داود في مراسيله بلفظ ذبيحة المسلم حلال ذكر اسم الله عليها أم لم يذكر ورجاله موثقون. From Ibn Abbas, the Prophet is reported to have said that the name or the title of the Muslim is enough. If he forgets to say the Bismillah when he sacrifices, then let him mention the name of Allah, meaning say Bismillah, and then eat the meat. This hadith is mawquf as a statement of Ibn Abbas. It also has a supporting evidence in Abu Dawood's Mursal collection, which says that the sacrificed meat of the Muslim is halal, whether he mentions the name of Allah over it or not. And that narration, as the book collection suggests, is Mursal, hence it cannot be attributed to the Prophet. And the Marasil we know are Da'if, generally speaking. The Madhahib of the A'imma, Malik, Abu Hanifa and Ahmad, is that if the Muslim forgets to say the Bismillah as he sacrifices, then the meat is halal. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i says that saying the Bismillah is mustahab, it is sunnah, and we mentioned this opinion before. So based upon this opinion, even if he intentionally does not mention it, the sacrificed animal is still halal. What this hadith does establish is that you say Bismillah when you eat. And we have other authentic evidence for this as well. So before you eat, you say Bismillah. If you said Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, then there is no problem with that. And Ibn Taymiyyah says that this would be better. But with regards to the dhabh, you say Bismillah. It is not appropriate to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim because ar-Rahman and ar-Rahim are to do with mercy. And this is not fitting when you are killing something or someone. We have mentioned before the ruling of saying the Bismillah as you slaughter the animal. One opinion is that it is wajib, but if he forgets to say it, then it is halal to eat the meat and the sacrifice is good and proper. And this is the majority opinion from the Madhahib, Malik, Abu Hanifa and Ahmad. The second opinion is that it is mustahab. This is the opinion of a Shafi'i, and they will use this hadith to argue their case. They will also use the other hadith about the people asking the Prophet that some people bring some meat to us. We don't know if they mention the name of Allah over it or not. And the Prophet allowed this meat to be eaten. We discussed that issue as well. And then the third opinion, the one held by the Zahiriya, is that it is wajib to say the Bismillah, and without it, the slaughtered meat would be not halal to eat. And this is the correct opinion. So we say that if a Muslim forgets to say the Bismillah or he is ignorant of it, then clearly there is no sin upon him because of the well-known ayah in the Qur'an, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا. However, there's a difference between sacrificing the animal and eating the animal's meat. Allah Jalla wa'ala says that you are not allowed to eat any meat on which the name of Allah has not been mentioned. So the one who's going to eat the meat, what excuse does he have? He has no excuse. So here we have a case where the correct opinion is not the same as the majority opinion. And of course we discuss the objections to the correct opinion. Some may say it is a waste of meat and a waste of wealth. We say no, the dead meat is not wealth, therefore it cannot be a waste. And then secondly, this strict opinion is going to straighten the people out. They will not forget to mention the name of Allah in the future, and that is better in the long run. Okay, let's take some review questions. Question number one. If some slaughtered meat is brought to you and you're not sure if the slaughterer has made mention of the name of Allah Jalla wa'ala or not, then what is the correct stance on the matter and justify your answer? Question number two. We found that the Prophet ﷺ forbade people from hurling stones. Why did he do so? Meaning, what's the justification? Question number three. What's the ruling on if an animal is sacrificed, is slaughtered, and the animal was pregnant with a child? Is this child permissible to be eaten, or what? And justify your answer with evidence.